It was once said, you can see a world.
So we're going to zoom in.
In a grain of sand.
So we're looking at a grain, a single grain.
At Northwestern's Integrated Laboratories for Earth and Planetary Sciences, a single grain may reveal worlds beyond our own.
Oh, look, you can see the green color already.
Professor Steve Jacobson's keen eye.
Oh yeah, this is it.
Is examining a single speck from the surface of the moon.
This is the well-known green glass collected during the Apollo 15 mission.
This is the view seen by Apollo 15 astronauts Scott and Irwin as their spacecraft Falcon arched over the Hadley Rill, located in the foothills of the moon's Apennine Mountains.
8 feet minus one. Contact. Bam!
Here's what it actually looked like to the moon riders as they drove their four-wheel car over 16 miles of lunar surface. As a result of their increased mobility, the pair returned 180 pounds of lunar rocks and deep core samples.
Using a single grain of that Apollo 15 sample and scoops of lunar soil simulant, Jacobson is embarking on a NASA mission of his own, funded by the space agency to study lunar soil and lay the groundwork for building on the moon.
One of the reasons they called me is because I'm a mineralogist. And so I know a lot about the types of minerals and the composition of minerals that occur on the Earth and Moon.
In this Evanston lab, Jacobson and his PhD students.
When it interacts with those atoms, it can eject electrons from the atom itself. And that process results in the release of energy as an X-ray.
Are examining samples of simulated lunar soil.
We are classifying their composition and their grain size. Each mineral has a distinct fingerprint.
It's part of the Artemis program.
NASA's mission to return humans to the moon for the first time since 1972. In a few years, two astronauts will land on the barren landscape at the South Pole, and the first thing they will encounter, other than 1/6 gravity, are tiny particles.
NASA's goal is to build a permanent base on the moon. But to build up, they have to know what they're building on.
If you want to go to the moon over and over again, you know, back to the same place, the first thing you need is a landing pad.
And a landing pad would stand on lunar soil, which is called regolith.
And it's just pulverized rock.
It's a fine powder made up of shattered moon rock. Its sharp edges can be rough on astronauts and their equipment.
Well, everything's getting awful dusty. Everything is just full of dust.
It's also an uncertain surface for construction.
Because if you put a spacecraft down on the surface of the moon, you're going to sandblast everything around your campsite. What's going to be challenging is shrinking this down to about the size of a shoebox and putting it on a spaceship. But it's going to have to withstand some pretty severe shaking during liftoff.
Jacobson designed this device, which uses lasers, computers, and a powerful microscope.
So this gives us very high spatial resolution.
To unlock the mystery of simulated lunar soil.
We're going to look at individual grains of this sediment, of this regolith, under high magnification to take a Raman spectrum.
Raman spectroscopy is a technique that measures how the vibrations of molecules change laser light.
Looks okay, that might be glass.
The way the light is changed allows scientists to identify the exact substances.
By looking at a lot of peaks on a plot that our system generates, and once you get to know what each of those peaks means, you can figure out what minerals you're looking at.
You could give me the tiniest invisible grain of sand, and we'd be able to collect a spectrum from it.
With the analysis of each grain, they're creating a library of lunar soil profiles. The information will eventually guide the building process on the moon.
As the first bricks on the Earth were made from Earth soil, the first bricks on the moon will be made from lunar soil. But to get there, we have to develop all of that engineering.
Since it's incredibly expensive to bring raw materials from the Earth to the moon, any lunar outpost will likely have to be built, in large part, from lunar soil. which will be fed into 3D printers to make the building blocks of a base camp.
A pretty exciting and groundbreaking task, installing the first 3D printer to be flown into space.
In a lab at Northwestern.
We're just getting started.
It's the beginning of something grand, from a single grain of sand. In Evanston, Mike Lowe, WGN News.